Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Swati Chitnis. I'm a consultant gynecologist and endoscopic surgeon at Shalby Hospitals. We are today going to discuss about a case of gestational thrombocytopenia, which basically in plain language means low platelet count in pregnancy. Now we all know what platelets are and we all have heard about low platelet counts in various conditions. But today we are going to discuss specifically about low platelets in pregnancy. So this is a case which we recently did over here. So I'll give you a brief history about the patient. The patient was a 31-year-old primary gravita, as in it was her first pregnancy. She came for a routine checkup in the second trimester. She was fine, she had no complaints. She was taking iron, calcium and folic acid. She had a mixed diet. All her routine ultrasounds were within normal limit. She was normotensive, normoglycemic, as in blood pressure and sugars were normal. Now her platelet count was progressively falling, but it was above 1 lakh till 35 weeks of her pregnancy. That means almost 8.5 months. Her liver enzymes were increased. There was no bleeding tendency. There were no patches on the skin, purple dots on the skin, which might indicate spontaneous bleeding. And she had no history of any febrile illness or any rash. That means there was no significant history of any infection. Now we can have a look at her serial CBC over here. So we have hemoglobin, total white blood cell count, platelet count and manual platelet count. Alright, so we, as you can see, from October till April, her platelet count is constantly falling, but it was above 1 lakh till December. And after that, it kept on falling below that. Now, as you can notice, on 3rd of April, suddenly the platelet count jumps up. So this was a day after the delivery of the baby. So that is why we came to the conclusion that this was purely pregnancy related. After almost 11 days of delivery, the platelet count was absolutely normal, 3.3 lakh. We will have a look at the other investigation. Like I mentioned, the liver enzymes were elevated, SGOT, SGPT and alkaline phosphatase. Rest of the liver function tests like bilirubin, proteins, albumin, globulin, they were all normal. Hepatitis B was negative. All her blood clotting tests like PT, APTT, INR, they were all normal. We did tests for immune phenomena which might lead to destruction of platelet. What we can see over here significant is immature platelet fraction, that is 60.8. That means the immature platelets were high in number in blood, and those were the large platelets that were not being detected by the analyzer, and that's why we were getting a better number on the manual platelet count. So now we'll discuss what might be the causes for these. So first of all, there is some thrombocytopenia physiologically happening in the pregnancy. There are a couple of reasons for that. First of all, there is hemodilution. That means blood gets a little bit diluted. So that is why you might see relatively a lesser number of platelets. It is mild. It does not affect the mother or the baby. And pregnant women who are having low platelet count tend to tolerate it better than women who are not pregnant. Now what is gestational thrombocytopenia, which was the case in this patient? So it is mild thrombocytopenia. Any thrombocytopenia means platelet count less than 1.5 lakhs. And it is observed in as much as 7 to 10% of pregnant women. That means up to 1 in 10 of every pregnant woman might be having low platelet counts. So it is a diagnosis of exclusion. When you cannot find any other cause, then we label it as pregnancy related low platelet count. Now it is mild, that is platelet count mostly remains above 70,000 and it resolves after delivery. It usually appears in the third trimester, that means last 3 months of pregnancy, and the baby does not have any low platelet count. Baby's platelet counts are normal. It can recur, that means happen again. So we need to differentiate the causes of low platelet count. So these will be preeclampsia, which is usually high blood pressure, and HELLP syndrome, idiopathic thrombocytopenia purpura, and acute fatty liver of pregnancy. Now these are potentially life-threatening both for the mother and the baby, and we need to rule this out. So how do we differentiate? Now, ITP or idiopathic thrombocytopenia purpura, it is usually chronic. The patient might be aware before the pregnancy that her platelet counts tend to be low. It is associated with symptoms. Patient might have purple patches or dots or rash like on skin, which is indicative of spontaneous bleeding. She might be suffering from heavy bleeding during her menstruation, that is menorrhagia. It is usually detected early on in the pregnancy during routine examination. It is mediated by immune system. Now, what about HELLP syndrome? HELLP syndrome, basically, it's a short form for hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes, and it is frequently associated with preeclampsia. Now, what is preeclampsia? Preeclampsia is usually changes associated with high blood pressure, which we previously used to call pregnancy-induced hypertension. So it has hypertension, there is a loss of albumin in the urine, there is a lot of edema, that is swelling, and it may be associated with dysfunction of liver and kidney. So you will get abnormal liver and kidney function tests. What about acute fatty liver of pregnancy? Now this is very, very specific. There will be fever, there will be jaundice, patient will have fatigue, lots of appetite, liver enzymes will be through the roof. What is pseudo-thrombocytopenia? Now in this, the platelets, they just clump together. So the machine is not able to count them separately. So you get a false low platelet count. Now this is very easy to diagnose. As soon as you make a smear, you can see the clumps of platelets and you can diagnose that this is not actually a low platelet count. So when do you need to do a detailed workup? First of all, if you know the patient has had low platelet count from before pregnancy itself, then if there is early occurrence of thrombocytopenia, that is in first or second trimester, if the platelet count falls below 75,000, or if the pregnancy itself is showing some complications and associated with that there is low platelet count, in these cases we need to investigate more thoroughly. So what are the tests your doctor is going to advise you? So this is a long list of investigations, but it is necessary because we need to rule out viral infections, we need to rule out any clotting disorders, we need to rule out any immune mediated disorders, and after everything is ruled out, then and only then we can diagnose it as gestational thrombocytopenia. So what are the practical aspects? Now you will not find it in any textbooks or any research papers or maybe even on Google, but these are the practical aspects which the patient, the relative or me as a doctor will face while handling this condition. First will be, it requires a multidisciplinary management. The gynecologist, the hematologist, the transfusion physician together will manage this patient. The second will be the psychological aspects. Now, in diseases, we don't go into psychological aspects much, but the kind of anxiety the patient and the relative will be having, they will be worried about the mother and the baby. We have to address that as well. The third thing will be the arrangement of platelets in the patient who are not due anytime soon. So what we generally do is we give platelets right before delivery. But what happens with the patients who are not due or who are showing any signs of preterm labor, but you don't know whether they are going to deliver or not, because the life of platelets is just 5 days. If you reserve them and don't use them, it just goes waste. Now, how did we manage this case? So first, most important is co-management with the hematologist. So hematologist is an expert in disorders of the blood. So we have to manage these patients along with the hematologist. Then we have to rule out all the other causes of low platelet counts. Then we have to repeat the blood investigations weekly, CBC with manual platelet count. We did a lot of patient counseling because these patients are usually very, very worried. They are worried about themselves. They are worried about their baby. They are worried whether they will transmit this problem to the baby. So you have to give ample time to counseling the patient, to talk to them, to talk to the relative and allay their anxiety. We did a close monitoring of the mother and baby because in some cases, if there is some other disorder associated with low platelet count, it can affect the baby and its growth as well. Then we kept the transfusion physician in the loop. We informed them when the patient was admitted in labor. We always inform them that in what condition patient is admitted, whether she's in latent labor, whether she's in active labor, whether we are going to take her up for a C-section. And we have to inform the transfusion physician beforehand that such and such patient is under us and is expected to deliver on this date, so that they keep everything ready. We have to consider low dose steroids right before delivery in case the platelet count falls below 50,000. So you have to counsel patients for that only, because steroids are, they have a very bad name. So if you are going to give steroids to some patient, we have to speak to them, we have to inform them. We cannot give them without informing the patient. Now, mode of delivery. How do we deliver these patients? Now, it is decided purely by obstetric status of the patient. How much ever is the patient platelet count, it is not going to decide the mode of delivery. Then why is it important? It is important because we want to maintain a particular platelet count to deliver the patient safely. For a normal delivery, 50,000 platelet count is sufficient, but for a C-section, we require a count of minimum 75,000. Now, what we did in this case, this patient was admitted in latent labor at 38 plus 5 weeks of gestation, which is quite close to her due date. After observation for 20 hours, there was no progress in the labor, so we decided to augment her with oxytocin. So oxytocin is a hormone which induces contractions. After observation for more 6 hours, there was no change, so it was decided that we will take her up for cesarean section. So we had to transfuse 4 units of RDP, that is random donor plasma, which is rich in platelets, to give her a sufficient platelet count. The patient was delivered by cesarean section. The indication, as we discussed, arrest in first stage of labor. The operative time was 40 minutes. Now, why is this important? We have to finish the surgery as fast as safely possible, because we do not want to prolong the surgical time and prolong the time in which patient will be bleeding. There was no intra-op bleeding. There was no post-op bleeding. The amount of bleeding was as per expected for any normal patient. When we repeated a CBC on day 3, which we routinely do for all the patient, it was normal and it showed normal platelet count. Like we saw in the slide previously, it was around 1.7 lakh. So what are the key points? What do we learn from this? First of all, in all pregnant patients, we have to do routine investigations. We cannot do that on booking visit. We do investigation and other blood tests are straight after 7-8 months at the time of delivery. At least CBC sugars have to be done every 12 weeks. Other investigation we can add as per patient requirement. We have to devote time to counsel the patient and relative. We have to have specialist backup with us. We have to have hematologist. We have to have a transfusion physician to manage these cases. We have to have 24/7 availability of blood banks, emergency services, doctors, and operation theater. We cannot manage these patients in a setup where all these are not available. For the doctors, we have to be a little bit liberal in asking for investigation. Sometimes we hesitate, that shouldn't happen. Now, what all to avoid? So this is for patients as well as the doctors. We should not delay the referral to other services. As soon as we have some suspicion that this patient might be, having some low platelet count, some sort of thrombocytopenia, refer her to a specialist to investigate further. If we do not repeat the investigations periodically, we will never diagnose this condition. So we have to avoid, not repeating the investigations periodically. Then one thing we have to avoid is hasty and brief explanations. We have to give time to the patient. If we tell them something in a hurry, they might not understand. They might start feeling insecure. They might get more scared. They might lose confidence in you. So we have to give time. Then another no-no is managing any high-risk pregnancy such as this in a small setup which is not well equipped for a 24/7 service. Then sometimes we tend to be conservative and reserve less amount of blood or blood products for any patient. We should not do that. We should be liberal in reserving. At the maximum, some blood products might not be used, but it is, like we say, better safe than sorry. So these are the things that we learn from this case. This was managed beautifully because we had a very good emergency setup and backup of physicians with us. That will be all. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe, stay home.